The following program is a production of HEW Entertainment and contains views, opinions, commentaries, and content that may offend some subscribers of this show. Listener's discretion is advised.
If you have an opinion on our show, let us know what you have to say through the power of social media.
Man, I am so excited about this. This is going to be so much fun.
Picture me without you, but I can't, 'cause we could be immortals.
Jonathan Clark is a legend. Everyone's realized that. And everyone I think is a Jonathan Clark fan, they just don't admit to it. When my time comes, I just hope that everyone remembers who I was, and that was really just Jonathan Clark.
Picture me without you, but I can't, 'cause we could be immortal.
Jonathan Clark with you, and I'm going to take a couple of minutes on my show this week to say thank you for the support that you guys have shown me ever since 2017 kicked off. You guys have been subscribing to me all throughout social media, on social media networks like Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Google+. You guys have never given up on me. You're always subscribing, and when I ask everybody who subscribes what they like the most about the content that I'm always throwing up on social media, you say to me that you can never get enough of my videos, my audio commentaries, the content that I generally post all the time throughout social media, on social networks like Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and now on Google+, which is booming with subscribers and content from our website's newsfeed. Thank you guys so much, everyone from all over the world, all walks of life coming together. Can't get enough of the worlds of entertainment and professional wrestling that I've somewhat merged together on my YouTube channel. And yes, if you've noticed, I've grown out a little bit of a beard out of disappointment and depression from the 2017 WWE roster shakeups of Monday Night Raw and SmackDown Live. I'm going to get into all of that from my latest video blog, which I'm streaming live on my YouTube channel. Thank you guys so much for getting in on my show's conversation. And if you haven't gotten in on my show's conversation, you're missing out on a lot of content, including my brand new look, my beard. You can tell me what you think of that on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and on Google+. What did you expect to see out of the 2017 roster shakeups for WWE? I thought we were going to see a hell of a lot more than what we saw, and you can get in on the conversation and tell me what you were expecting to get out of the 2017 roster shakeups. It seemed to me like WWE changed the concept from trains to the shakeup because they were trying to continue to keep up with the trend, if anything, of the major sports organizations of the MLB, the NHL, the NBA. Like, they were always talking about trains for years, and now they've changed it from trains to shakeups. So it seems to me like they're trying to keep up with the trend of the major sports organizations like the MLB, the NBA, and the NHL. And I think that WWE are receiving a lot of criticism for having done that, because in recent years, we have heard it called the trains, which happen every year around WrestleMania, which is considered the finale of the WWE season every year. And now that we've seen the finale of WWE season this year, WrestleMania 33, offers so much in the way of an incredible showcase of the immortals, like they call WrestleMania every year. They've changed it from the yearly trains to now what is being called the first ever and of many to come, the WWE roster shakeups. The biggest thing that we saw in the roster shakeups, obviously, were the shifts of the Intercontinental and United States Championship divisions and the champions who represent those respective divisions, Dean Ambrose coming over from SmackDown Live to Monday Night Raw, and Kevin Owens coming over from Monday Night Raw to SmackDown Live. It's going to be somewhat of a different feel. After Payback, the United States Championship will start being defended on SmackDown Live for the first time in years since the first time it premiered back in 2003 as a WWE Championship after crossing over from World Championship Wrestling. After that organization was purchased, they also purchased the rights to the championships to relaunch them as WWE variations. So this will be the first time ever since the premiere of the championship back in 2003-2004, when the inaugural champion was crowned, which was Chris Benoit, thanks to Eddie Guerrero, thanks to Rhino, in that incredible match at Vengeance in 2003, they had So I'm really looking forward to seeing the United States Championship defended on SmackDown for the first time in what will be years, and how that will change the direction of WWE here in 2017 and this new generation of talent that will be competing in the United States Championship division with Kevin Owens as your United States Champion. It's also very different calling him the United States Champion as opposed to having called him the Universal Champion, which we've been calling him ever since last summer when Finn Balor went down with that unbelievable injury, which was so unfortunate. Another big thing that happened in the fallout of the 2017 roster shakeups is that Finn Balor will remain on Monday Night Raw following his incredible return on the first Raw in the fall of the WrestleMania 33. He's going to be in a program with Bray Wyatt, which I'm really interested in seeing where we go from here with that, because we've never seen Bray Wyatt and Finn Balor feud before, either on SmackDown Live or Monday Night Raw, and whether or not Bray Wyatt will follow through with his claim of reclaiming the WWE World Heavyweight Championship for Randy Orton at the Raw exclusive pay-per-view coming up in 2 weeks' time. Payback, the House of Horrors match, which really closely resembles to me the Chamber of Horrors match from the early 90s in World Championship Wrestling, which if you haven't seen, you've got to go on YouTube and check that one out. Initially, I thought it was going to be at a SmackDown exclusive pay-per-view on the network. We were going to see Bray Wyatt and Randy Orton for the World Championship. But it's really interesting, the concept of this match and how Bray Wyatt now can take the World Championship to Monday Night Raw for the first time in a while if he's successful with a victory over Randy Orton, which he's been promising after Randy Orton's been having the better of him gotten by Wyatt family members on Raw and SmackDown in recent weeks. I like the interpromotional feel of this match, and how that match can change the complexity of the championships in WWE, the major ones, the World and Universal titles. Also, I like how the United States Championship could be altered as well, with Chris Jericho and Kevin Owens having a United States Championship match also at Payback. The winner of this match, from what I understand, will become a member of the SmackDown roster exclusively. So not only Kevin Owens could be picked up in the fall of the shakeup, also Chris Jericho, if he's successful, could go to SmackDown transitioning over from Raw. Which leaves the question whether or not we're going to be seeing whoever wins the WWE World Championship House of Horrors match defecting to whatever brand they defect to, either Raw or SmackDown. So, you know, with the complexity of the United States Championship being altered, the complexity of the World Championship could also be altered. So we do have a lot of interesting concepts that are now altering in and factoring someone in to the Payback pay-per-view, which again is a Raw exclusive pay-per-view. And I also, again, you know, huge thumbs up going out to WWE for the interpromotional matches that we are seeing at the first pay-per-view and doing it so early in the fall of the WrestleMania, because usually every year around SummerSlam time, that's the latest time we see interpromotional contests, like we saw last year with Randy Orton and Brock Lesnar main eventing SummerSlam, which set up for the series of matches that we saw this year between Brock Lesnar and Goldberg, with the latest happening just recently at WrestleMania 33. Really big fan of Bray Wyatt coming to Monday Night Raw, though. I initially thought that the biggest thing that happened on Monday Night Raw in the fall of the shakeup was Kurt Angle being named general manager by Vince McMahon, the chairman of WWE, because of the previous time that we saw him as the SmackDown GM back in 2004, 2005, and how much success we saw Kurt Angle and how he affected and changed undoubtedly the direction of SmackDown for years to come in the fallout of Kurt Angle's initial reign as the WWE general manager of SmackDown. Now we're going to see him lend a hand to the Raw side of things, the red side of things, and see what he can do to change the complexity of that. I was hoping initially that was going to be the biggest thing that would happen, or the Universal or World Championship divisions will be altered from Raw to SmackDown or SmackDown to Raw. But I thought that what happened with Bray Wyatt coming over from SmackDown to Raw was something that was really cool, because now we can see the World Championship scenario altered, which I'm really looking forward to. And not to mention, I've been the biggest Bray Wyatt fan in recent years, ever since at least 2013 when he debuted alongside Eric Rowan and Luke Harper as part of the Wyatt family ever before. Braun Strowman was brought into the mix, who is altering into this program between Brock Lesnar and Roman Reigns over a dispute of who is the inferior one who defeated The Undertaker. Really like this triple threat scenario we're looking at for Payback, also in the fallout of not only WrestleMania, but the roster shakeups as well. Some minor shakeups that we saw also were Apollo Crews coming out from SmackDown Live to Monday Night Raw. Really interested seeing how he'll factor into possibly the Intercontinental Championship division with Dean Ambrose and The Miz coming over from SmackDown Live after what they did for the Intercontinental title over there. They could probably do the same thing along with Apollo Crews and possibly someone like Kalisto, who I would imagine would be either in the Intercontinental Championship division or the Cruiserweight division, because about Sin Cara now has gone from Monday Night Raw over to SmackDown Live. Looking forward to seeing how that's going to happen, because of how they lost Sin Cara, who was initially supposed to have been a huge part of the Cruiserweight division on Monday Night Raw. Now he's gone to SmackDown Live. Kalisto coming over after they were successful as the Lucha Dragons. Really confused about how they did not bring over the Lucha Dragons. Rather, they chose the Shining Stars over the Lucha Dragons to be a factor in the and Heath Slater and Rhino in the tag team divisions. Really shocked about how they didn't shake up the rosters by bringing over the Lucha Dragons from SmackDown Live to Monday Night Raw, because they could have been a huge factor in the tag team division. What we saw for tag team wrestling in the shakeup this year were Heath Slater and Rhino coming over from SmackDown Live after initial reign as the SmackDown Live tag team champions, coming over from SmackDown Live to Monday Night Raw, and the Shining Stars going from Monday Night Raw to SmackDown, which they're looking at as the biggest opportunity of their young careers. That's why I say the Lucha Dragons could have easily factored into this rather than just being shifted over from brand to brand as singles competitors, because they were such huge fan favorites as a tag team. The Lucha Dragons were really over in WWE, but for some reason, they keep teams like the Wyatts together. They keep teams like the Shining Stars. They keep teams like Heath Slater and Rhino after initial reign of SmackDown Live Tag Team Champions. American Alpha are still together. I was really hoping we're going to see more shakeups in the tag team division. So if anything let me down about that, it's definitely the tag team division. And really the biggest team.